not going to be boat planted anymore?
No, we're still going to plant.
Boat stock? No more boat stocking? Is that what we're?
No.
No.
No, we're still going to plant.
No more boat planting?
No, we're still going to plant.
I'm clear.
No, we're working with it.
I signed a letter.
So, the boat stocking, you know, we own the boat. And Catherine Nordholm out of our office runs the STEP program, Salmon Trout Enhancement Program. She will set up the boat stocking just like we've done it in the past. And it's our expectation that that Don's going to have a fish there at the boat landing at 8 o'clock in the morning when we get ready to run that boat down the river. He'll dump the fish in there. The truck will move down to the next location, meet the boat there, and it'll be as we've done it.
That's all specced out in the contract?
No. No, that's going to be an agreement between, that's going to be the Tom's agreement with the state to get those fish in the management plan that we have laid out here that you guys have in front of you.
With the state and the Army Corps, it's going to be an agreement between all of us.
And the McKenzie guys.
Yes, and the McKenzie guys. That's all right.
Let's not forget the McKenzie guys.
Would Steve indicate that it's his opportunity to speak to us now? And again, we will have an opportunity for follow-up questions after we hear from Steve. We've moved into that question and answer opportunity. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
And our fourth presenter is Steve Maylie. He is a former Air Force intelligence officer, big game river outfitter and guide in Idaho, a forest supervisor on the Shoshone and Boise National Forest, co-leader of Interior Columbia Basin Ecosystem Management Project, and manager of wildlife, watersheds, and aquatic ecology for Boise Cascade Corporation. He is president of the McKenzie River Guides Association, vice president for conservation and the Boone and Crockett Club, and a member of the board of directors for McKenzie River Fire and Rescue. Steve?
MRGA is a not-for-profit corporation founded in 1931. To aid in the conservation, restoration, management of the fish life in the McKenzie River, encourage optimal game and fish management, promote public participation in guided McKenzie River trips. There are 129 members in four categories. There are 59 active guides and 70 associate members. Each year, the guides serve clients who enjoy more than 2,000 recreation service user days fishing for trout, salmon, and steelhead in the McKenzie. A reasonable estimate is that annually MRGA guides serve over 1,000 McKenzie angler clients, most pursuing hatchery trout, contributing over $250,000 to the local economy. For over 8 decades, MRGA has worked on projects and issues related to fish and river conservation. Our 86-year legacy of conservation leadership stems from a commitment to caring for the McKenzie River and teaching anglers how to reasonably share its bounty, guiding those in pursuit of hatchery trip, that is hatchery trout, is a key part of that legacy and a vital part of the business plan for most guides. The Liedberg Hatchery, as we know, was built by the Corps of Engineers in 1953 to mitigate for the loss of trout production and habitat due to the construction of Cougar and Blue River. The hatchery produced the mitigation trout of 270,000 pounds per year for the Upper Willamette Basin, 50,000 pounds, 18% of the total, provided annually to the McKenzie. Liedberg Hatchery has been operated by the OFW for nearly 60 years through a co-op agreement with the Corps of Engineers. For all of that time, for 60 years, ODFW, the Corps, and the McKenzie River Guides Association have been mitigation partners. The Corps has provided funding, ODFW has reared the fish, made the plans, and the guides have distributed most of them throughout the river via plant mowing. For fish distribution, an essential part of mitigation, ODFW and the guides have worked together annually producing and implementing a McKenzie River Fish Management and Allocation Plan, determining where, when, and how many fish would be stocked by planter boat, a partnership program unique in Oregon, operated and paid for mostly by the guides. The following excerpt from my email to Tammy Mackey, who is the Corps of Engineers and is Chief Fisheries Biologist in Portland, elaborates the importance of a detailed fish distribution plan and implementation as part of the Corps' mitigation responsibility. This is a quote from my email. Frankly, it didn't appear to me that Tammy, assisting in the preparation of the contract, had a good understanding of the importance of distribution. The email read, "Currently, approximately 34 miles of the McKenzie River between Blue River and Hendricks Bridge near Walterville are stocked each year with about 50,000 pounds of catchable trout. According to the attached allocation schedule," I sent her the 2017 plan, "for about two-thirds of stocked fish, the guides operating a plant raft meet the fish carrying trucks at appropriate designated landings, 10 of them, pick up the fish and distribute them between landings. This provides a reasonable opportunity for drift boat anglers to catch fish throughout the drift between landings. It serves recreational anglers on the McKenzie since it is essentially a drift boat fishery, being limited by restricted river access and the general lack of wadeable fishing water. Without the current fish distribution system, hatchery fish stocking would be limited to truck fish dumps at landings, concentrating fish pressure at these sites and essentially minimizing fish presence and fishing opportunity between the landings, probably around 95% of the river. This would greatly reduce McKenzie River fishing opportunity, a consequence inconsistent with the mitigation responsibility of the Corps. In addition, it would likely reduce or eliminate McKenzie River guiding industry as we know it because of client loss due to the absence of non-release fish and related fishing opportunity between landings. The Corps contracting action resulting in consequences including reduced mitigation and industry loss appears to be a major federal action, calling for an EIS under the NEPA. I went on to say I would appreciate your willingness to review the August 2nd, 2017 contract with Summer Lake Trout Farm doing business at Desert Springs to determine if and how the matter of fish distribution is addressed relative to the detail above. If it's not, hopefully it can be amended to provide for a system similar to that currently in effect." Mackey's response to me, October 3rd, indicated that any fish distribution plan like that currently in use and referred to above was not part of the contract and would not be in the future. It was suggested to me that the guides could reach out to Desert Springs and, quote, inquire about an arrangement for assisting with releasing fish. However, there is nothing in the contract directing such an action. The new contract. September 15th, Summer Lake Trout Farms, doing business at Desert Springs, was awarded a $1.2 million contract to produce and release rainbow trout in specified waters in the Upper Willamette Basin. The Corps stated that the contract provided for the entire historic mitigation amount of 277,000 pounds per year. The delivery schedule of the contract, Appendix 1, and I have a copy of that contract, states the percent of total pounds of fish to be delivered by month to general locations. For the McKenzie, those locations are 1, Leeburg Lake Reservoir, 2, McKenzie R1, and 3, McKenzie R2. I have no further definition of what R1 and R2 mean, and they're not specified in the contract. No more specificity for time and location of delivery and distribution is provided in the contract. New partnership. Well, as you might guess, at that point, I was deeply concerned. September 26th, Joe Rowlater, who's sitting by Stan back there, representative of Desert Springs contacted me to indicate that Tom, owner of Desert Springs, quote, does not intend to change anything, unquote, referring to the 2017 McKenzie River allocation by size plan, which had been sent to him and is agreed upon by ODFW and McKenzie River Guide's fish plant plan and distribution schedule for 2017. A phone call between Tom and I and September 27th confirmed the Desert Springs intent for fish delivery and distribution to follow the plan agreed on by ODFW and MRGA, and we really deeply appreciate that call. It was agreed that Desert Springs, McKenzie River Guides, ODFW, and Army Corps of Engineers should meet soon to work out the trout fish plant plan and distribution schedule for 2018. Previously, Jeff has distributed that 2018 McKenzie River allocation site plan, plan by size for delivery and distribution of Desert Springs raised trout for the McKenzie. McKenzie Guides looks forward to a meeting of all concerned partners at the earliest opportunity to finalize the plan. And we intend for there not to be three participants, we intend there to be four. I want to close with a look at the past. Dr. Paul Needham was a renowned trout biologist in Lindahl. He was also director of fisheries with the Oregon State Game Commission between 1944 and 1948. In that capacity in 1948, he suggested a plan to use a, quote, liberation boat, unquote, or a floating live box to liberate legal-sized fish in the McKenzie. As a first test, a five-man rubber boat was filled half full of water and was roped downstream from Fin Rock to Silver Creek. While it performed satisfactorily, according to those that watched, a wooden boat was deemed more practical for liberating purposes. Soon after, a wooden boat, that is a wooden planting boat, built specifically for fish liberation by Woody Hyman, was launched and given a trial on the front pond at what is now called the old McKenzie Fish Hatchery. To remedy the problem of the boat rolling over when it was half full of water, an inflated rubber tube made of 5-inch tubes circling the boat at water level was installed. The improved boat was approved by the Portland headquarters. With a workable plant boat, approximately 31,000 legal-sized fish were liberated in April of 1949 between Belknap Bridge and Emmerich's Ferry, landing a distance of some 35 miles. Following that first trip, the boat was altered to allow for better circulation of water. Well, I included that to show that this is not a trivial partnership. It started with the director of ODFW for fisheries 68 years ago. And you don't talk about the fishery in the McKenzie without talking about the guides as a whole partner in the process. The guides have been working in close partnership with ODFW for 68 years, effectively delivering and distributing country trout to better serve the public and their enjoyment of the McKenzie and its fishing opportunities. Some of the greats in both organizations, Needham and Hyman, have their brands on this one-of-a-kind of partnership. With a new chapter that's beginning, the opportunity to strengthen the legacy is clear with a new partner, Desert Springs, eager to begin, and the old partners proud to continue. Together, we'll welcome the next 60 years on the McKenzie.
Other questions for Steve? Seeing none. So we'll open it up to general questions for any of our panelists. So with you, sir.
Yeah, Greg and Jeff, maybe you can answer this. You talked about the present hatchery down here, getting rid of it somehow and so forth. What happens, just hypothetically, and I'm not saying this is going to happen, but say this doesn't work, and you've said that this is basically a one-year contract going on, and all of a sudden we need that hatchery back. Where are we at?
Well, we have a mitigation requirement here, right? In the store, we have a mitigation requirement for trout. We will have to procure trout, period, to meet that requirement. I mean, that's the bottom line.
So, my basic question is, if you get rid of that hatchery, then that's out of the picture, as far as going back.
And you're aware a good chunk of that mitigation is not being produced at that hatchery now, right?
That's correct. Sure?
This is a question for Jeff. How many local people are gonna be losing their jobs at the Leeward Hatchery? And is there anybody at headquarters also?
Yeah, that's a good question. There's a lot of people that will be displaced. Minimum of three right now. There's some of the folks have already left, as you're probably aware. And so, you know, there's a lot of things still up in the air, as Greg was alluding to. You know, we don't know what's gonna happen with Leeward Hatchery. Obviously, it's not funded any longer. And so, regardless of whether we have it or not, we would have to come up with some kind of funding mechanism for the hatchery. In the interim, we expect the people at the hatchery to find positions elsewhere, probably sometime in the next 7-8 months.
In the past, there's been about five families there, hasn't there, or six?
Something like that. Actually, Stan, you could probably tell me how many families were there when you were living there?
Seven. Three duplexes and then the hatchery. Let's just hand that hand over here, some space.
A mechanical question. When we were planning out of the boat, we restocked the boat up to four times. And that takes a delivery from Leeward Hatchery to the location. They drop 2,000 to 3,000 fish. And then that typically, that truck goes back down, refreshes itself at the hatchery and comes back. If you've got a truckload of 9,000 fish, and we've got to parse that out between four launch points, have we got the mechanics to do that?
That's just one of our trucks. We've got four trucks that hold 2,000 pounds. We've got four trucks that hold 2,000 pounds of fish. We have two smaller trucks that hold 1,200 pounds. And we've got one truck that holds 5,000 pounds, and a new one coming on that holds 4,200 pounds.
So it's possible then you dispatch three or four trucks?
If it takes three or four trucks, that's what we'll need.
Thank you. Yeah. Sir, just a question for you, Tom. I have some fish over there. Those are from your guys' hatchery there?
Yes.
What is the difference there? Let's see a couple smaller ones and one that takes that one.
The smallest one is the 3 to the pound. The one is a 1 pound, and the big one is about 5.5.
How long does it take for like your 1 pound fish there? Is that for him to
about go 9 months?
9 months? Huh.
Yeah.
Like nice fish.
Yeah, and I guess kind of a concern. You know, there are at least four organizations, four clubs in this vicinity that represent anglers. I belong to one of those organizations. I don't see, I mean, I appreciate Steve being here and speaking on behalf of the guides and the service that they provide to the public at large. But I don't see anybody from the general angling public involved in this discussion. And I'm from my organization, NETS, who's been been party to a lot of what's gone on here on the Mackenzie River. We're really disappointed that this conversation has not been extended into the angling public and into the angling organizations. So, you know, I'm hoping, and I'm, you know, on behalf of my organization, again, the Association of Northwest Steelhead, that we have a seamless transition here, that the folks that I represent in our organization represents is what this is really all about. And again, there's nobody from that community on that board. So, I'm concerned, but we will. We wish you good luck, sir. We will look forward to participation in our community here on the river, and I hope that if any other gathering goes forward, that we see some representation from the community of anglers that are passionate in this part of the state.
Being relatively new to rivers and the fish in the rivers, are these fish GMO fish?
No.
Were the original stock genetically modified organisms, or you're saying no, it's not?
But these fish are called triploid fish. What they are is they're incapable of reproducing. But GMO, I'm not sure how you would define that. You know, you could. The process for making triploids is you put pressure on the egg at the time of the first division. And what happens is the rather than kicking out those extra sets of chromosomes, they are kept within the nucleus of the cell, and so they have three sets of chromosomes where most have two sets of chromosomes. Is that genetically modified? I don't know. I wouldn't call that genetically modified. They're just triploid.
Sir,
Tom. I queried before how many fish you could haul in one load. Now my next question would be, obviously you're going to pick up 2,500 fish at a boat landing, 2,500, 2,500. Now if you're going to haul all of them in one load, I don't know whether the truck's going to, that's what I was curious about.
No, it'll be three trucks.
So then you have to have three drivers and
yep.
Overheads on its way up, which is not in business, but.
Well, not really. You know, we programmed when we did our bidding and everything, we programmed it a certain way. It's going to change a little bit, but it's still going to work out okay. We have 18 trips that go down to Mono Lake area, and the truck goes down with 1,600 pounds, comes to Reno. And we have another truck sitting there, and we just switch drivers, and the truck's back down doing the delivery. So we do this all the time on switching trucks and drivers.
I guess what scares me in part is what Steve said is that in regard to the contract, there's no wording specifically that you have to carry out what you're carrying out. Is that correct?
Repeat that again.
There's nothing in the contract that says you will deliver 2,500 fish.
No.
See, because you could, if you really wanted to, back the truck down and dump them all at Silver Creek.
Absolutely.
See, that's the scary part for those.